Welcome to Salvation Temple Church, where the hope is on you. Welcome to Salvation Temple Church, where the hope is on you. Welcome to Salvation Temple Church, where the hope is on you.
From 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50, did I get your number yet? 60, 70, 80 years ago, that's still having impact, consequence today.
Yes.
So, in my regular effort of getting before the Lord God and saying to Him, what is it? Where can we go forward? We've had tremendous message lesson last week. I mean, Mrs. Scott came and swung for the wall. Pew! And the ball went over the fence. I didn't hear you cheering, but it went over the fence. And the week before that, it was just like, you know. And last week, I was down in Houston, Texas, and I shared some of the kinds of things that we were talking about here. And while I was there, the Spirit of God, and I'm looking around, see, I don't see anybody who's underage up in here that it can make a significant difference. But I got an insight while I was there of how to say what I said the last time. Last time I said we need to teach our young boys that their penis was not made for an ear. And some people caught that and some people still don't understand what I was talking about. So then when I was in Texas, the Spirit of God, this wasn't old nasty Stanley, the Spirit of God said to me, the way to say it is, tell a young boy his penis was not made for somebody else's trash can. You know, if the trash goes out, you don't put, that's not what that's supposed to go in that place. But, you know, I mean, there's big highfalutin movie stars and TV personalities and some people who will fight you tenaciously to say that that's okay. And they, people like that, want your children and your grandchildren to get into that kind of lifestyle. And they want to misuse them. Okay. And they develop little groups in schools and they have big organizations on college campuses and executive offices and many other places where that kind of stuff is, it's held up as to being, well, that's okay. And the Word of God tells us, no, it's not.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
It's not okay.
Amen.
Well, but that's archaic. That's old-fashioned. The Bible is old. So we got a new generation now. We got millennials. And we decide what's okay and what's not okay. How many gods is there? Say one. And the one God said in his word that that's not okay. So we got choices to make. We're going to choose to do what God say against big, loud voices and strong action and activity. To say, oh, no, God is wrong. God misunderstood. And actually, some of them say, this is God's fault. They say that kind of craziness. You say, well, now, Pastor Scott, why do we have to put such emphasis on those kinds of topics and that subject matter? Can't we just go along in order to get along? So somebody say no. And what is it? Why is it such a big deal to have to deal with this kind of information in the first place? Well, because, I try to say it as simple as I can, because when you see all that stuff going around in the system, in society, and you see those different kind of things constantly coming into your face and into your ears and all that, it has an impact on other areas of your life that don't have nothing to do with that. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, what happens is when they change the truth of God and make it a lie, then that damages and weakens the power of truth in other areas of our lives. And so, in preparation for this message today, I heard the Spirit of God say so clear to talk about the truth of the matter is. So that's our eWORD subject for this morning. The truth, in all caps, truth. The truth of the matter. And to drive that straight up home, right up in our face, is I want to push you to find out where are you with the truth of God. And one introduction statement says, often we have all said in some way or another, or some way or the other, the truth of the matter is this and thus and so and this and that. One of the ways that may be even more familiar to us is that when we say, well, see, what happened was this. That's why I did that. And what happened was, gives a reason for why I didn't do what I should have done, which I knew I should have done, which I recognized that if I didn't do it like that, I was going to be in deep trouble, but I still didn't do it. And then have the audacity to be upset when mess actually comes to pass. I mean, You spelled it mess. You arranged it to be mess. You tracked it down. You invited it in. You gave it a little cup of coffee. And then you surprised that it pee on your carpet? Hello? So what happened was? Well, my biggest point today is to put forth this reality. The reality that truth really matters. It really does. The truth does in fact set us free. It will make us free. Truth helps us live peaceable lives. And my heart is straining to have you leave this place today with an attitude that come what may, rain, cold, snow, storm, or wind, I'm going to believe the truth of what God said about me. Amen. Huh? Now, when you make that kind of decision, sorry to say, you're going to have a fight on your hands. Because your mind is going to fight you. Your emotions are going to try to trick you. Your friends, relatives, and neighbors are going to look at you like something wrong with you. And they're going to try to talk to you and convince you that what God said to you, I mean you, what God said to you, they're going to try to tell you what God said to you he didn't say. Huh? We got this big thing going on in news media about there's six people in a room. And 49 people that wasn't in the room gonna tell you what happened in the room. And the six people in the room said it didn't happen. Well, here's my attack. Here's my challenge to tell you, here are some decisions that you need to consider if you're going to walk out of here, as it were, live a peaceable life, enjoying being who God said that you are. Not what your emotions say that you are. I want you to be able to enjoy and live like who God said that you are, who Jesus died that you could be. And I bind every spirit and attitude that tries to convince you that their lies are so. And that this information, these scriptures, was written for somebody else. Doesn't apply to you. Oh, the Bible says, we're blessed going in and blessed coming out. Oh, the Bible says, I'm the head and not the tail. Well, that's, so your emotions are going to try to help you say, well that doesn't really mean what that's not really what he meant. Well, that sounds like Genesis, don't it? And my wife was saying to me yesterday or the day before, you know, what was it? Eve was really convinced. Eve was really deceived because it must have been that she really thought that what the devil said, that it was going to be like he said it was going to be. And so when he said to her, what did God say? That's not what he really meant. Because part of the issue is God wants to keep all these good bananas and apples for himself. And he don't want you to have any. But if you eat that apple, that's what the devil was telling Eve. If you eat that apple, God knows you're going to be just like God. And she, like a lot of people, not y'all. She, like a lot of people, said, really? Well, let me just, looks good, sounds good. Let me just reach up here and touch it. It even feels good. And, oh, it broke off the tree. That must mean the will of God for me to go ahead and bite it, aren't you? Well, we look at that. That's kind of like how Eve did it. But there's other ways that we do it. We do it when we have these issues, when the pain is so strong till you can't hardly see straight. You ever had something hurt you so bad till it just, the room is blurry and swimming around? And you kind of have this thing like, whew, if God healed me, how can this room be swimming around like this? And deep on the inside, something inside of you is going to say, well, then healing must not be true. It does. It does that. And I'm not talking about folk on the street. I'm talking about born again Christian types. Amen. Have that kind of situation go on. And right in the face. I mean, on the days, the Sundays, when we do communion, do the Lord's Supper. I mean, some people will sit and hold that blood in their hand and get ready to sip it down. The blood of Jesus. And still have the attitude. Well, you know what I did last week. Hey, it's kind of like, I'm going to drink it, but soon as somebody says something, they're going to remind me of whatever that was. And therefore, the drinking don't matter. But there's a scripture. What's our main script? What's our main text scripture in Ephesians chapter 4? I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying that. So here it is. This is our main text scripture. All right. I want you to get ready to read this, and I want you to read this with intent. I want you to read this with a sense of okay. Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 21. Ready? Read. Yes. Then what? Do the last phrase without the "as." Say it out loud. The truth is in Jesus. Say it.
The truth is in Jesus.
Yeah. One more time. Say it.
The truth is in
Jesus. Where? Say in Jesus.
In Jesus.
One more time. Say the truth. What? No, it's in NBC and Fox and CB. Where's the truth? No, it's on the internet. And hey, watch this. The truth is in Hollywood. Where is it? Where is it? Then when you want to know what the real truth is, where do you look? In Jesus. I'm going to say, where do you find it? And you say, in Jesus. Where do you find it? Say it stronger. Where do you find it? So don't be looking.
Amen.
In other places. And other stuff. To help you decide what truth is. The school board and city council and other places will tell you that the truth is different than what you already know is in Jesus. So then you got a decision to make. You got a choice to make.
Yes.
You have to decide, am I going to go with the truth of Jesus? Or am I going to go with the truth of the council or the board or the society or the system? And you may say, Pastor, excuse me. You messing with my retirement. You messing with my livelihood. I just can't go to the classroom and tell the children that penises were not made for trash cans. They will fire me and sue me, and I'll lose my job, and they'll take away my retirement, and then I'll have to scuffle for the rest of my life. I can't do that. The union won't protect me. And I pay union dues. They take my union dues, whether I want to pay them or not. Well, hey, you got a decision to make. Now. Well, Pastor told me I should come in here and tell you that the truth is in Jesus, and I'm not going to do that anymore, and I quit. No, I'm not telling you that. I'm not telling you that. But I'm telling you that you need to pay attention to how you allow certain things to have impact on you.
Amen.
especially when those things are against the things of Jesus. And then when you let those have that kind of impact on you, then I can promise you it's going to affect other things
yes.
that don't have anything to do with that thing. And the place I'm trying to get to is in, I'll use this expression, I'm trying to get to in the heart of your heart. I'm trying to get to the very depth of your spirit. I'm trying to get to the very essence of your reason for life and have it be anchored in the truth that is in Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah, you're going to lose some friends when you decide the truth is in Jesus. Some people are going to talk about you. They're going to make you they're going to press on you. They're going to make you think that you think you're better than everybody else.
Amen.
And they're not going to have anything. And then some people are going to try to mess you up and get even. Because you believe that the truth is in Jesus and you allow that to anchor itself in your spirit, in your heart, in the heart of your hearts. And you will tell your emotions. We're going to believe Jesus.
Amen.
Now, hope you don't mind me saying this. Sister Lucy Thompson's brother just made his transition the other day. And it was a traumatic situation. It's really hard. I mean, she was there with him most of the day, most of the night. He was writhing in pain. They had to strap him down, restrain him, screaming the whole nine yards. And eventually, his physical house couldn't handle the stress anymore. And God took his spirit out. Of his body, according to his word. And when his spirit left his body, where did he go? According to the word, where did he go? I can't hear you. Where did he go? To be with Jesus. To be absent, what? With the body is to be what? Okay, then what? Well, now, is that better? I can't hear you. That's better? Then, how are we going to handle the crying? How are we going to handle the sadness? How are we going to handle the pressure on the memory of our loved one? Now, I'm not talking about her now. I'm talking about you now. I'm talking about you. And who else am I talking about? You and who else? Your mama. Because like I was telling my wife, because we were talking this too, she was saying like, you know, how do you get from a certain aspect of how you live your life to a place where you live a better life, etc.? Because at funerals and stuff, back when I was a young boy, I would want to climb in the casket. Oh, I'd be screaming. I'd be all fault. They had to carry me out. The nurses was fanning and all this. I was acting a butt. And then I told you this story before. When my mother died, I was so mad at God. I did not pray for a whole year. I didn't read any Bible. Somebody said, well, you just got to stand on the word. I said, you better get out of my face. I don't want to hear that mess. That was my mama. And I acted ugly. And I'd be down praying, Cynthia. I'd be down on my knees praying, and I'd hear God come and want to talk to me. I'd get up. I didn't want to hear nothing he had to say because he took my mama. And he didn't let me know she was leaving. And I'm talking, what kind of God are you? So then, in this discussion I was having with my wife, she was kind of like, well, how did you get from those places of wanting to climb in the casket and being mad at God? She said, was it because you just made a decision? Was it because you spend time reading the Word? What was it that makes you do differently? And what does it take to make you not let your emotions? Because right now, I can make myself cry till y'all had to go call EMS. I mean, right now, I can just get into an emotional fit right now. So could you. You laughing, but you could too. You see about what they said and what happened and what they did and how it felt. And you just go into a tizzy. Emotion is that strong. I'm saying, you can sit here in the church and make yourself have an emotional fit. You can hold a communion cup in your hand and have an emotional fit about not being healed. Emotions are just that strong. So what's the difference? Why are you able to just sit here right now, read the scripture, and go on and do better things? Because you make a choice. To believe that the truth is in Jesus. Huh? And what has... Now, so let me see. Because the truth is in Jesus, and because we want to believe that God's word is true of what he says about us, I need to take a few seconds here and have you tell me some things that you've heard from God's word about yourself. What have you seen? What scriptures have you seen? What scriptures have you read? What do you hear coming from God's word that talks about you, yourself, you? What has God said some things about you? You're more than a conqueror, and that you're the righteousness of God, that you're his child. What is God saying about it? Does he say that he supplies every need of yours? According to his, how many of you have looked in God's word and actually saw that he said you're saved? Huh? You saw that in the word of God? Well, being then that you're saved, what does that mean about where are you going? Where are you going? Heaven. And watch this other biggie right here. How are you saved? Huh? By grace through faith. Was it something you did that got you saved? Well, what makes you think, watch now, that there's something that you do that causes you to be unsaved? When did Jesus, as it were, obtain your salvation? Huh? Say 2,000. 2,000 years ago, he sealed your salvation. And how long did he seal it for? Say forever. So, did you work to get that salvation?
No.
Watch now. Can you work to lose that salvation? Say no. So why do we spend so much time focusing on the sin? What we did, what we said, especially as if what we did, what we said, the sin that was around makes us any less loved by God. Hmm? That's the truth. That's the truth. What did God do with your sin, according, you don't have to turn it. What did God do with your sin, your transgression, all that kind of stuff when you confessed? And so what did he do with it according to what the psalm has to say? Huh? Yeah. Michelle says, he cast it as far as the east is from the west. He pushed it, as it were, into the sea of what?
Forgetfulness.
To never rise again against you. When did he do that? Say 2,000 years.
2,000 years ago.
Uh-huh. So how is it that you and me can have the audacity to say, oh God, you know what I did. I'm so sorry for what I said. What's he going to say? Come on now. Now I'm drilling into this because this is where it's good for us to be. What's he going to say? Because what did he do with it? He cast it. He put it into the sea. I forget. He forgot it. So then how's he going to treat you the next time you see him? Like it never happened. Well, if God does that for you, how much more should you do that for? Not other people. No. How much should you do that for you? Yeah. Because how we deal with us determines how we respond to stuff going on around us. And when you decide, you declare that according to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 30, Jesus has been made unto me wisdom, say it out loud, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. That's the way it is. That's who you are. So are you going to believe that or not? So it boils down to, okay? So now, and I'm getting ready to wrap up here in a minute. I just got these few more scriptures and I'm done. You see, the situation is, all it takes for me is just like about 3 to 5 minute conversation. Well, not even 5 minute, 3 to 5 minute conversation with you. And I can figure out where you are with the truth of Jesus about you. Amen. Only take about 2 or 3 minute conversation, because as soon as I hear some of the things you say, then I'll know based on what you say where you are with the truth of Jesus. Okay, now, let's just do it like this. Go ahead and put up the next scripture, which is, you can skip on through the highlight point, but Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 15, speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ Jesus. And I had a little heading up there about speaking spirit power. And I've just come to tell you, and I know you've heard this before, and I've said it before. Mrs. Scott has said it before. You've seen it. You've heard it on the DVDs and seen it on TV and what have you. What you say has power.
Amen.
So stop saying stupid stuff.
Yes.
Speak the truth in love to you, about you. Huh? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. And, this be new was the head, the be new. And that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in what? Righteousness and what else? True holiness. Holiness or hell. You understand what I'm saying? You know, is God or the devil? The devil is real. Huh? Sin is sin. And when you allow sin to take over your life and you give yourself into the devil, you go into hell. Okay? Well, the joy is we can put on a new man. Hmm? Sometimes it just fascinates me. I do a little flipping Facebook and all this, and it just fascinates me. The number of people constantly changing their hairstyle, constantly putting brighter stuff on their face. You see them this time, they got this going on. You see them that time, they got this going on. And the next time, they got this going on. And the next time, they got that going on. How come you just can't be new? Hmm? You do it when you go to the hairdresser. How come you can't do it when you go in the closet? Oh, did you get that one? Yeah, went over here, okay. If you go into the prayer closet, huh? Dumb it down. Break it down. Break it down. When you go in your prayer closet and God tells you you're a new man in Christ Jesus, when you come out of the closet, you should have a new walk. You can have a new talk. You can have a new peace. You can have a new joy, huh? Coming up out the prayer closet. Just like you go to the beauty, what the name of this show? Beauty Parlor, Beauty, what was it? No, the movie. There was a movie show on, they called it Beauty Shop, where they had all of that stuff going on and the chit-chat and everybody's business and child and all this going on. That you sit up in there 3, 4, 5, 6 hours. Come on now. Notwithstanding, you had an appointment. And they still kept you for 6 hours. Come on now. And God asked for 5 minutes. And you want to like, excuse me, God, I got stuff to do. Huh? You want to have peace in your life? Yes. I almost want to say, spend as much time in the prayer closet as you do in the beauty shop. Yes. either you're going to put on a new man or not. Yes. If you say, and I don't now. Where's, oh, she over here. Deborah Fisher said, now, you touch a certain button, and I'll kick my high heels off. And I'll walk you up the street one side and down. Where'd that person come from? How new was that? Come on now. Okay, so then now. Yeah, checks in the mail, babe. Checks in the mail. I'm going to take care of you. I promise. Well, now, this true holiness business is awesome. Because holiness, being holy, God will fight your battle. Without holiness, no man, come on, we'll see God. That means holiness ought to be important enough so that you can see God. And therefore, since it's so important, that means you need to be dealing with it. All right, so here's my last little quiz, and then I got one more verse, and then I'm done. Two more verses, and I'm done. Okay, so when you hear holy, what does that mean, holy? What does holy mean to you? Say holiness, true holiness. Acting like him. You always say what else?
Complete.
Complete. How about paying attention to cracks, crevices, and cleavage? Now I saw Mrs. grab her coat and do like this right at the. I know you didn't mean that, does it? Huh? Holiness. I'm out here, so I might as well go with it. So when they take your picture for your prom date, and you standing there like this, what does that mean? Just what are you saying? Why are you wearing it down to here? Huh? And why is it split up to here? And listen, if I send my daughter, which has been so long, if I send my daughter with you, you ought to read this thing this guy writes. Didn't you write it, Aaron? Here's some rules for dating my daughter.
Yeah.
Hmm? Right. First rule is I got a gun. Second rule is don't blow the horn, you come to the house.
Yeah.
Third rule is I got a gun. The fourth rule is don't touch her, don't put your hands on her, don't put your lips on her. Fifth rule is I got a gun. and the next statement, and bring her back on time, and she better not have no marks on her. And the sixth rule is I got a gun. And it's loaded, cock locked, ready to rock. But listen to me, you send your daughter out there with a guy. Her thing is split all the way up to here. It's all tight all up in here. Her boobs are hanging all out there. And why are you going to get upset with him? Come on now. Come on. Just help me. Help me. Either we're going to be new men or not. Yeah, but everybody's doing. Mom, why? Why do I have to cover up? Have some respect about yourself. So say out loud, new man, to me, new man. And say holiness is right. Okay. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. We run that through that real quick. Say it, believe it, say it. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. There is, next highlight, there's life in truth. There is life in truth. I went way back to Ezekiel chapter number 18, verse number 9. Pulled up the scripture here. It says, when he hath walked in my statutes and hath kept my judgments to deal truly, he is just. He shall surely live, saith the Lord. When you deal truly, come on now. I don't know. This is one of those stupid little Stanley Scott kind of examples. I say to people all the time, you don't have to come to Salvation Temple Church and steal a bottle of water. You don't have to tuck an extra bottle in your bag and sneak it out. I mean, I go over to Costco and buy you 45 bottles for $3. Why you want to sneak one? Come on now. Deal truly. Huh? We had a rule at our house. We leave money laying around. You know, some people tell me, well, I have to lock my room against my children. What? They live in your house, eating your food. They're wearing clothes you even listen. Even if you buy your own clothes and you live in my house, you still in my house. I don't have to lock no door. I don't have to put my money up because it might be gone when I come. What? We have to teach our children. If it don't belong to you, you don't put your hand on it. Huh? Okay, I'm over time. Excuse me. Teaching point, you have the greatest control over the quality of your life, so make it strong by truth, by you doing truth, you believing truth, you accept truth, you anchor truth in your spirit and in every opportunity that you have. When something comes up, deal with it from the position of truth. And God will be there to help you. Action point, self-check inventory is the best method to get to this place of understanding where we are. So therefore, just do it. Now, I added a few phrases that I didn't have when I printed this out. Here's how you know where you are on truth. This is how you know where you are on truth. Number one, you look into you. Because you know. Say out loud, yeah, I know. Come on, yeah, I know. Come on. I know what I'm thinking about her. I know what I'd like to hit him with. But you look inside of you. Then you listen to you. Sometimes we get engaged, sometimes we get involved, and we end up saying stuff. And we, in the moment, we don't even realize we said it because we were so involved in what was going on. But if we ever back off and just listen to what we said, we would say, ooh, I'm not going to say that no more. Right. Amen. Then I wrote this one down with a little hesitation, but I said, have others tell you what they hear from you. Now, this has to be a trusted somebody. Somebody that you know, that you have good confidence in. But because a lot of times we're so involved in stuff, at the moment we just say it and somebody walk by and say, woo, you know. You ask them, over the last two or three telephone conversations that I've heard, what have you heard me say that you would really consider that I should reconsider what I said or how I said it, huh? And then the determination point becomes, enjoy your new and free life in Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, maybe next time we'll have fun and laugh and joke and all of that. But I'm telling you, truth really matters. And you being true to Jesus, you being true to yourself, then you live truly, walk truly, act truly, deal truly, then new life and peace. And especially if your peace is all exaggerated, it's all exacerbated. If you're struggling with peace, if you just can't sit down for a few minutes and just sit there and just be quiet, no phone, no TV, no this, no that. If you're having struggle just being able to sit there, then you need to deal with some things. You can start playing now. So listen to me. I love you and I thank God for you. And I want the very best for you. I said earlier in the message part, all I need to do is hear you for about 3 minutes. And I can identify why things are happening the way they're happening. I can identify why I see the countenance on your face that I see. And my big, big challenge for you today is for you to accept that you are who God says that you are. Not what your body say, not what people say, not what society say. You are who God says that you are. And I went by a little while ago trying to ask you, what are some of the things the scriptures say about you? And some of us struggled a little bit, but hey, he said we're the head, not the tail, we're above, not beneath. He said that we should pray without ceasing. He said that we're more than conquerors. He said that He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. He says we're the healed. He says that it is His pleasure to give us the kingdom, and He has great joy in our prosperity, and our prosperity goes beyond money. What's that one about life and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost? Huh? Be multiplied, yeah, towards us, and seek first the kingdom of heaven and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So, stand up on your feet if you will. Thank you for those of you on the conference call. Thank you for those of you watching by YouTube. I know, did we finish up our Facebook Live? Something happened. You left. Wireless? Okay, we'll figure it out. Get it working better. So go to YouTube and we'll play it there. I don't know if you want to hear this again, but you should listen to it so it can help us get to the place of peace and power. And get to the place where we decide, in the face of storm, in the face of anxiety, in the face of emotional upheaval, that we will choose to be in the truth of Jesus. Way I'm able to walk by caskets is because of spending time in the Word and Scriptures and making the decision. This is what God said. And therefore, other things have to conform to what God's Word has to say. And I choose to trust God to live in the love of Jesus. Amen. Lift up your hand, let me pray for you. Father, I thank you in Jesus' name for this time of being able to share your word with your people. We say and believe in Jesus' name that the manifestation of your efficacious word brings truth alive on the inside of us. Increase our sense of boldness to walk in, to receive your truth, to believe your truth, to walk in your truth, live in your truth, and give you praise and glory for the many good and wonderful things that come to pass in our lives as a result of the manifestation of your grace, mercy, and your truth in us. We pray this prayer in the matchless name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Check us out on our website, stc.church. You'll be blessed there in Jesus' name. Let me share with you the gospel. The gospel is found in the gospel according to John chapter 3. Over there at verse number 16 is a magnificently powerful verse. I'd like us to take time to just read it again very quickly. The words are on the screen. Let's read it together out loud. Ready? Read. For God. Yes, He did. And this gospel points us to salvation. Salvation is found in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. We use 9 for an example of this particular section. And I want us to read that together out loud. Ready? Read. That if thou shalt confess. What happens? Thou shalt be saved. Sure enough, sure enough. His word is true and it comes to pass in our life. Pray this prayer out loud. Say, God in heaven, thank you for today. Your word is true. I believe you love me. Sent Jesus to die for me. You raised him from the dead for me. I receive Jesus in forgiveness of my sins. I make Jesus the master of my life. He is my Lord, and I declare I'm saved. I'm born again in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, God bless you. Thank you so very much. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and be seated.
Thank you for tuning in to the Salvation Temple broadcast. We'd like to invite you to our weekly services, Sunday mornings at 10:45 a.m., and Wednesday evenings at 6:45 p.m. Or join us for our conference call by dialing 530-881-1212 and entering the access code. We look forward to seeing you at Salvation Temple Church, where the focus is on you.